Welcome to the show, Comedy Bang Bang. My name is Scott Aukerman, and coming up on today's episode, in a second, we have an entertainer. Oh, an entertainer. It's funny how entertainers are always, they seem to be the first guest on this show all the time. Always in A block. If you come to Comedy Bang Bang, look, we know it's the show where we talk to interesting people. We know, of course, that it's humanities podcast, but I think it's also becoming the show where we speak to entertainers in A block, apparently. So that's a new catchphrase for us. And then in B block, we will be speaking to a broadcaster. Oh, okay. Oh, a fellow broadcaster, I might say. And then in C block, we have a famous relative. Okay. All right. So this is an exciting show. I wonder if any of our other guests are famous relatives. Oh, I think one of them is. I think our broadcaster actually is a famous relative or has a famous relative. I don't know about our entertainer if she's a famous relative, but that will be, of course, the first question that I ask. I promise our listeners I will ask her that. So why don't we get to it? Our first guest is a newcomer to the podcast, but she is not a newcomer to comedy. What'd you think of that?
I like that.
That was a good segue, right?
I'm a fan.
We first saw her in Last Comic Standing. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And she is on a roll right now. Every time I turn on my television, she is there. That may be because I've installed a nanny cam in her house.
I thought someone was watching me.
But I have currently seen her in Kenan on NBC. I watched her in Barb and Star Go to Vista Del Mar, which is one of my favorite movies of the last year. I've seen her in the Netflix Afterparty with David Spade and London Hughes, our friend London, who was just here. Mm-hmm. Also in an episode of The Wedding Coach coming up in about a month. She's in everything, but she has never been on Comedy Bang Bang until now. She can finally check this off the old bucket list.
Woo!
And if this is the last thing on your bucket list, prepare to die.
Oh, no.
I like saying that to our guests. Please welcome to the show, Fortune Feimster.
Scott, it's so cool to be here. Thank you.
It's so great to see you. Now, you and I have done a couple of shows together recently, and I thought, gosh darn it, I gotta get Fortune on the show.
I gotta get that bang bang.
Welcome to the show. And by the way, you are in a movie that just came out yesterday.
Yes. It's a family movie on Netflix with Jennifer Garner.
Oh, a family movie starring someone's family, or it appeals to families, or both?
It's both. It's about a family that says yes for 24 hours. And it's a movie that you and your family, your whole family, can watch without the kids having to put on the earmuffs.
Fortune, you're everywhere now. One could almost say that Fortune Feimster is having a moment.
Am I having a moment? I don't know. I filmed a lot of these movies and things before the pandemic. And they were at different times, and they were supposed to come out at different times.
It would be weird if you filmed them all simultaneously.
It would be.
You said one line over this camera, you turn to the right, you say a different movie's line over to this one.
There was a time I had to leave one movie set during my 2 days off, and I flew to another one to film something and then flew back. So it was a little crazy, but everything got pushed because of the pandemic, and then nothing was coming out. And then all of a sudden the floodgates just opened and they were like, release the movies. And so it just, all these movies are coming out right now. And it just looks like I do nothing but film movies, which is, I wish was the case, but not the norm.
What percentage of your life is filming movies? Now, I would imagine that roughly one third of your life is sleeping.
One third, yeah. Definitely got to get that 8 hours in.
Uh-huh. And then filming movies, though, would you say that that takes up the other two thirds of your life, the other 66.666666666%?
Not so much. I wish. Usually people have me pop in movies and I play some bonkers character who's ridiculous or kind of off. Just like a hair off in life, just weird person. Or I play a very joyful, happy person, and then I'm out of the movie. And so you can film that stuff pretty quickly because you're just in a couple scenes.
But that, okay, so that brings me to a great point. You're a very joyful, congenial, happy, smiling type of person in real life, and that's translated to the types of roles that you play. Although, I guess, in Kenan, you seem a little more down to business, it seems like.
Yeah, her name's Pam. She's a sportscaster, so she takes sports very seriously.
Well, that's great, because we have a couple of sports guests on the show. You'll be able to, I don't know if you want to get into character for those segments.
Okay, yeah, I sure can. I can get, she's more competitive.
Can you access Pam?
Yeah, like right now, or?
Yeah, sure. Okay, so let's see a little Pam. This is Fortune Feimster as Pam.
Well, Pam has a very similar voice as me. It's,
Yeah, seems it's a little deeper and more gravelly.
It's a little bit deeper. I'm pretty competitive. Fortune's not very competitive because she's a bit of a wuss. But I don't like to lose. And so if I'm in something, I want to win.
Are you doing Pam right now? I can't quite tell. This is
Pam.
Oh, hello, Pam. Pam, it's so
also,
nice to meet
Pam
you.
Pam also has her hair slicked back.
Oh, okay, yeah. So I don't know if we have time to wait for that.
Yeah, Fortune doesn't know how to brush her hair, so it's different.
You also, by the way, speaking of home, I don't know if we were speaking about it. Were we talking about home? I don't know. That's a strange segue that I may have invented in my mind. Maybe I looked at you when you were at home. I mean, you're at home right now. We weren't mm-hmm. talking about being at home before, but why don't we talk about you being at home?
Wait, am I Fortune or Pam?
Oh, shit. No, I'm sorry. Can we get Fortune back? Fortune! Can you hear me?
I'm back.
Oh, good.
Wow,
oh.
That was a trip. I really went outside myself and played someone totally.
Thank God. I've never lost a guest. That was close.
Yeah, I went so far beyond.
But you are at home and you're at home and you do a show that I've done a couple of times with comedian Tom Papa.
Yeah.
On Sirius XM. Is that mm-hmm. right? What's it called?
It's called What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. And we're on 5 days a week on channel 93.
And you've been doing it from home. The last time I was on the show, you were recording from home and you have not been able to do it in the studio. You haven't been able to be in a room with Tom Papa for a year now. What is that like?
We actually just had our year anniversary of taping the show from home, which was crazy.
Yeah, I mean, this week is actually the anniversary of the last episode that I recorded in studio.
So crazy. Yeah, we've done 180 episodes since.
Wow.
So we talk a lot, but it's for Netflix. So we get to just talk to comedians every morning. It's pretty awesome.
And you're from North Carolina, home to, I'm trying to think of the famous comedians, Zach Galifianakis.
Yep.
The end? Or are there more? Or
just such a Zach and I.
But you didn't know Zach?
I didn't know. I actually met Zach like a few weeks before the pandemic. Maybe it was a month before.
Do you think he caused it? That's my theory, I haven't seen him since. And that leads me to believe that he did something wrong.
He released something and then went to the woods. It was so cool to meet him just because we've always had... I take that back. We met before. I auditioned for something and we did the scene together for the audition. So I had met him. It had just been a very long time. But it was cool to see him again.
Right. And did you start doing stand-up in North Carolina?
I had done some theater in college. That was the extent of my performance.
The Immortal Bard? Speak the speech, I pray thee. No. Out, damn spot. Spanish head, etc.
No, we weren't that cool. I had this really... My accent's thick now, and my accent was even thicker then. So trying to do...
How did you used to talk?
It was even slower and even thicker. It was like, y'all, this is crazy. I can't believe we're about to do this.
How did you lose that intentionally? Or has living out here in Los Angeles just stripped you of that?
I think that just living in LA forced me to speak a little bit quicker, even though it's still very slow.
So what's the fastest you can talk? Let's try it. Like, read something. There's got to be something in your room that you, although quite frankly, I'm looking at your background and
I know
you're in front of a very,
very
blank white wall. You could be in a sanitarium for all I know.
I'm like, do I need to Google something to read?
There's got to be something in your room that you can read.
Oh, this is hilarious.
Okay. All right. So let's read this as fast as possible.
I just got a text. I want to set this up. I got a text
okay.
from a company selling something.
Okay, so this will be like a free advertisement for them.
Good news for boobs everywhere. Adjustable straps with stitch free smoothing comfort. Meters.
Hold on. Hold on. Hold on.
Wireless bra.
Good news for boobs everywhere?
It literally says good news for boobs everywhere.
Is it targeted marketing? Why am I not getting this?
That is hilarious. I was like,
Did you mention boobs? Or you know how when you say a word around your phone or you're watching television and they say a word, suddenly if you're on a website on your phone, you'll see an ad for the thing? Are you constantly talking about boobs?
I think it's actually from an ad from my podcast. I'm getting ads from my own podcast.
Oh, wait. This is one that you're supposed to read on your own podcast?
Well, I don't read that in my podcast, but this company is one of our advertisers for my podcast.
Okay.
But I guess I'm on their list now.
Okay, so you're getting text messages.
So I'm getting text messages. I'm also receiving pictures, which if you didn't know that this was an ad, like, my wife would think I was up to no good. This is the picture that they sent.
Oh, yeah. Get that off your phone.
I'm like, that's a picture it's, you're sending. That's hilarious.
It's I don't judge women's physical appearances, but that's a picture of what some might consider to be a sexy woman in a bra. They're texting.
Yes, that's a sexy young woman. A sexy woman in a bra, and if this were to have popped up on my phone and my wife saw it, she would be like, what are you doing?
And then suddenly she reads good news for boobs everywhere.
Good news for boobs everywhere.
Okay, I'm sorry I interrupted. Pick something else. Let's see how fast you can talk.
Oh, I don't... I gotta Google something.
Yeah, Google anything. Just go to Wikipedia. Or, oh, hey, maybe go to your own Wikipedia page. That would be a nice way to learn a little something about you. Because I can't be bothered to do much research.
Can you research yourself and tell us some things about you? Well, it actually has my full name on here. Emily Fortune Feimster is an American writer, comedian, and actress. Having made her television debut on NBC's Last Comic Standing in 2010, Feimster starred as Colette on The Mindy Project.
Faster!
In July 2019, she began hosting What a Joke with Papa and Fortune with Tom Papa, interviewing comedians and celebrities.
Faster!
The first live programming on the SiriusXM channel.
Faster!
Was a joke. In 2009, reports confirmed...
Faster! Not bad.
Then my head explodes.
You started at basically what everyone else considers to be normal speech.
I know.
And I could tell you were really pushing it.
It's a lot. It's a lot for me to exert energy.
I gotta say, though, as a stand-up comedian, talking slow is the way to go, because an hour of material for you is like like a Netflix hour is like a half hour for every other comedian. You can write less material.
Well, let's not get too crazy. It's not that slow.
Are you filming anything else that we can see soon? Hopefully this will not be a reversal of fortune on our TV and movie screen soon.
I know, where I just disappear. No more projects. Well, the Kenan episodes are still coming out, so I think I have four more of those to come. I still am doing the Netflix Afterparty, so more episodes of those
are
coming.
That's right. And London was very cagey, by the way, because
she
says she watches all of the episodes of, for instance, Bling Empire, right? That's the one I saw. She swears. And I made her swear on a stack of Bibles, by the way.
Oh, wow. That's a
lot of
Bibles.
So many Bibles. I've delivered a stack to your house, by the way, so you can swear on them.
Oh,
I think
man.
They're out on your front porch right now.
Okay.
But she swore that she watched all of the episodes so she could be really prepared.
Yep.
So I want to ask you about that. Do you bother to watch any of it?
We watch them. They tell us what we're going to be who we're going to be talking to, and because
I'm not expecting you to like watch every Netflix show randomly, hoping that you'll finally see the thing.
Oh man,
that
would be a lot.
About.
That would be a lot of watching television. Though early in the pandemic, I was watching everything on Netflix.
So say they say, okay, we're doing an episode of the Bling Empire coming up.
Yes.
Tell us honestly.
I watch half of it.
You watch half of one episode?
Honestly, I watch half of like the series. Except for Fate the Wink Saga, I watched every episode. I got hooked, Scott.
I don't even know
what
that is.
Don't judge me.
Fate the Wink Saga?
Fate the Wink Saga.
You're just making up stuff.
No, it's like Harry Potter, but for fairies. or with fairies. I guess it's not for fairies.
Not aimed at fairies. It stars fairies in the narrative.
This is a fairy's favorite show. No, I got hooked. I watched every episode of that. So it just depends on what the episode is. I watch, but I am a busy gal, so I can't watch them all.
Yeah. And you watch television slower because you're from the South, right?
True. My brain thinks slower.
You're constantly pausing every sentence. What did they just say so fast? Well, the Netflix After Party is out there, although taking a lot of time off from what I can tell.
It'll be back. It'll be back soon.
Yes, dear?
Yes.
Is that, yes, ma'am? Is that
yes,
what?
Day. It's based on a book.
Who cares? I don't think anyone watching Yes Day is like watching it like, oh, this is based upon a novel, is it
like,
not?
This book, it's very true to the book.
I feel quite intelligent watching this movie Yes Day.
Well, I think it was a very popular children's book.
Okay. But yeah. Well, then say based on a children's book. Oh. Don't say based on a book. That's lying by omission.
My bad.
Just trying to lure someone in based upon a bestseller. Children's book.
It's based on Twilight, the movie Twilight.
Oh, wow.
And the book Twilight.
Yes, Dear is out now, or Yes Day, Dear, Yes Day.
Yes Day, but whatever.
And Barb and Star, also out now. Everyone should rent Barb and Star. Great film. And you have a tinier part in that
That's
as well.
Right.
Seems to have been about 24 hours of shooting. Is that about correct?
Yeah, we flew out to Albuquerque and shot it all in a day.
24 hours in Albuquerque, that is a movie right there. Let's film that.
Please.
You and me, 24 hours. It's just you and me, 24 hours in Albuquerque. I had a tuna melt in Albuquerque once because I was taking a cross-country train trip, and it stopped in Albuquerque, and we had 1 hour that we could do whatever we wanted. And so I got off the train, went to the nearest diner, and got myself a tuna melt.
Wow.
What do you think about that story?
That's an amazing
10 out of 10.
1 hour in Albuquerque.
That's right. Now imagine 24 times that.
24 tuna melts.
Wow. That's all it is. Just me sullenly, silently eating 24 tuna melts.
And no one comes near you because your breath stinks. I actually went the day before, and then so we got to have dinner with Kristen Wiig and the rest
of the
people.
What's that like? What's having dinner with Kristen Wiig like? Boy, that sounds amazing.
It's lovely.
I bet there are young people interested in show business out there listening, and they want to hear a nice showbiz story. So hit us with what dinner with Kristen Wiig in Albuquerque is actually like.
It's pretty great because she's one of the most normal people ever. And you're like, you're very famous. And it's almost like she doesn't know she's famous.
That doesn't sound fun to me. Like
I
go out to dinner with a big star, I want them to be,
famous.
Yeah. You know, like this story, it needs a little jazzing up. So punch it up a little bit if you could.
Oh, you know, she was grabbing bread from the basket and shoved it in people's mouths for no reason.
Oh, okay.
She was tired of them talking. She didn't even say, can you stop talking? She just grabbed bread, shoved it in people's mouths.
Oh my God.
It was jarring.
So eccentric.
And then, just lots of, she had a hairbrush with her. She was brushing her hair during dinner for no reason, looking at herself in a mirror.
What a weird woman.
She had a wig.
She had a wig
with her.
Oh my
put
God.
It on, started brushing that. She was
That's
very
the dream to
brushing.
Have whatever your last name is on your person at all times.
Yeah. And then just at one point, just smacked me.
What? Where?
Yeah.
On
the boob. On the boob.
On the boob. Bad news for boobs.
Yeah. Bad news for boobs.
Oh, my gosh.
So, man, it was quite a Hollywood dinner.
Wow. Well, that's an amazing Hollywood meets Albuquerque story I've never heard the like of.
And I had the fish.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm not sure about the end of it. But
a nice halibut.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. It needs a button, I think. But wonderful. Well, Fortune, a pleasure to have you on the show. We need to take a break. Can you stick around? Because we have a couple of interesting guests. We have a broadcaster, a fellow broadcaster, because you and I are both broadcasters.
Right.
And this person is also a broadcaster. Mm-hmm. And we also have a famous relative. And I believe the broadcaster might be a famous relative. Are you a famous relative?
I have no one famous in my family.
Mm, they must be so jealous of you with stories like getting the halibut and all that.
Yeah. I have lots of Hollywood stories.
Well, we are going to be talking to them when they get on the show, which will be when we come back. I guess I'm in charge of this. But we have to take a break. When we come back, we will have more Comedy Bang Bang. We'll have the broadcaster and the famous relative, more Fortune Feimster. We will be right back with more CBB after this.
Hey, I'm Ernie Niekamp from the podcast Hello from the Magic Tavern. I'm here with my co-host, Chomp the Talking Badger.
Oh, yeah, baby.
And Usador the Wizard.
Magic!
I'm trapped in the magical land of Foon, where I host a chat show interviewing elves, unicorns, weirdos.
Someday I shall defeat the Dark Lord of Foon.
Sure, bud. Fake laugh to show how much fun we have.
Hang out with your fantasy pals every Monday.
Subscribe to Hello from the Magic Tavern on your favorite podcast app.
Comedy Bang Bang, we're back here. Fortune Feimster, and I believe you wanted to clarify something that we discussed right before break. Is that right?
I haven't been able to think about anything else for 2 minutes.
Me either, honestly, because I believe I asked you if you were a famous relative.
If I was a famous relative, and I thought you said, did I have any famous relatives? And I said, no, I don't have any famous relatives. And then I realized that I answered the wrong question. And I was like, I have to fix this.
Yeah. Or we got to clarify or else the Twitter scolds and corrections will be coming in at a fast and furious pace. You are a famous relative, but you do not have famous relatives.
There you go.
Now, I'm not quite sure about our upcoming guest. When we, a little later, we're going to have a famous relative or someone who has a famous relative. I'm not quite sure.
Okay.
We'll be talking to them. But before we get to that, we do need to talk to our broadcaster friend, who I believe is a famous relative and may have a famous relative. I'm not quite sure. But we've spoken to him before. What kind of sports are you into, Fortune?
Oh, I love tennis.
Oh, okay.
I played sports my whole life. Tennis, soccer, basketball, softball. And
anything round. You're out there kicking
anything
it or hitting
round.
It.
I like that. I'm trying to think if there was anything else. That was it. I didn't play golf. I wasn't good at swimming.
Though. Too tiny?
Yeah, too tiny. Too much. Yeah.
So it's got to be round and about bigger than a softball.
Exactly.
Okay. Those are the parameters. Mm-hmm. Well, I believe that our guest deals with round things that are bigger than softballs. So I believe you will be interested. No, not boobs. Not good news for boobs. I believe you'll be interested in this. Welcome to the show, back to the show, famous broadcaster and NBA legend in his own right. Please welcome back Bill Walton.
Wow. A pleasure to be here with Scott Aukerman and Fortune Feimster, one of the great comics standing from Josh Blue to Dat Fan, from Eliza Schlesinger to Alonzo Bodden. We've got Fortune Feimster. I'd watch this comic if she was the last comic standing, sitting, or lying down. Oh. Amazing to be here.
Wow, Bill, what an intro to Last Comic Standing.
Well, I mean, I think it was directed at you, not so much at Last. Although it did seem to contain a lot of information about Last Comic Standing, almost as if someone was looking at a Wikipedia page.
Are you on IMDb?
None of the above. It's my favorite competitive stand-up comedy show in the history of NBC's competitive stand-up comedy television shows.
Yes. The only one that I can think of.
Potentially the only one I've watched and the number one I've watched. And what a pleasure to be sitting across from two amazing on-microphone personas, from Netflix is a joke to Earwolf is a podcast network.
Here Wolf is a podcast.
My goodness, Bill, so great to have you on the show. Fortune, have you seen Bill's work?
I'm embarrassed to admit, Scott, I haven't seen Bill's work. I know he's a legend,
sure,
right?
Of course, we know he's a legend. Yeah, we just don't know anything about you. What team did you play for?
You flatter me.
Get your thoughts together. It's okay.
From the Boston Celtics to the Portland Trail Blazers, the great Bill Walton pulled down rebounds and blocked basketballs with the best of them.
How many points do you average per game?
Per game? I never thought about the points. I thought about the fun, and I averaged 25 funs per game.
25 funs? How do you measure that? Is that something where
high fives, butt taps, and cheek kisses in the European leagues?
Yeah. They show more affection in the European leagues.
Yeah.
Yes, over in Europe they do it. You know, there's a little less concern about male sexuality as there is in American sports.
Right. Although I will say in football, which is not a round ball, it's a football shape. There's really no other way to describe it. It's football shaped. They do pat each other on the butt a lot, it seems like.
They pat each other on the butt. The great Tom Brady kisses everyone on the lips from the owner of the team to the son of his loins.
the son of what? His loins. His loins. Oh,
His loins.
The son of his sloids.
Do you kiss on the lips when you celebrate?
Is that a question for me, or is this an open question for the audience, or is it for Scott specifically? Or
I'll
are you looking
it.
Into a mirror, the great Fortune Feimster?
I'm asking you, Bill.
I kiss on the lips only to celebrate the greatest of celebrations, Mother Earth. I've kissed General Sherman on the lips. I've kissed General Joshua Tree on the lips.
General Joshua Tree, wow.
One of the great large Joshua trees in beautiful California's Joshua Tree National Park, home of Bono's favorite recording studio, and not to mention the Omegatron, or whatever it's called, where you listen to crazy sounds from far away, I believe.
Wow, your job requires that you know a lot about a lot.
This is all curiosity, Fortune. I'm a man who loves Mother Nature, Mother Earth, and to read long books and just rub it in people's faces that I know these facts.
What do you love more, tie-dye shirts or Mother Earth?
Oh, don't make me choose, Scott Ackerman, not today!
I apologize.
Of course, tie-dye shirts I can wear on my body. Where's Mother Earth? It's take only the memories and leave only your footsteps. You cannot wear Mother Earth on your body like a tie-dyed shirt. So in one way, it's the tie-dyed shirt because it's a part of me. But in another, I am born of Mother Earth's loins, much like Tom Brady's son that he loves to kiss on the lips I mentioned erstwhile on the podcast.
So for Fortune's sake, and certainly not my own, you're a broadcaster. Is it on TNT? Is that right?
I broadcast for the entertainment sports PN network.
ESPN?
That's correct.
So entertainment sports, what is that P?
Premier? I really don't know.
It's locked up like the great secrets of American business, the recipe for Coca-Cola, or the recipe for...
Seven Herbs and Spices?
Yes, exactly what Scott said. The P and ESPN
will never be revealed.
Deep secret, and now that they're owned by Mickey Mouse, one of the great mice of history, you'll never get
Let's roll that. Who are the great mice? Mouses? Meese? Mice?
Meese. Who are
the great mice of history? We have, of course, those ones who helped Cinderella with the whole bibbidi-bobbidi-boo thing.
Yes, what's that one, the little tubby one's name? Tum-Tum or something like that. Is that Cinderella?
What was Fievel? Was that a mouse?
Oh, Fievel.
Fievel!
Come on.
An American tale, indeed. One of the great American tales.
So he's one of the great mice within one of the great American tales.
Yes! An inception of Fievels, I would say.
Ratatouille! Ratatouille,
of
course. Does that count?
He's a
mouse with an American accent. A rat, indeed, but living in the French countryside. Voiced by the great Patton Oswalt. one of the great humans in American history.
Human? You just give him greatest humans.
One of the greats.
I would say comedian, but humans?
Oh, he never appeared in the episodes of Last Comic Standing that I watched, so I'm not aware of his comedic exploits. Though,
you just know him as a human.
Yeah, just Patton Oswalt is one of the humans who I like to listen to.
Wow. Mm. What about the rescuers? Are they in the list of great mice, or are they just sort of middling?
My memory of the rescuers is they're from Down Under.
Well, they went Down Under for the sequel, and that's what made it unique. They were, they may be English or they may be American, but they're one of the two.
Scott, I have just texted my wife to cancel my plans to watch the prequel to Rescuers Down Under to see this great story you've told me of.
I think one of them is wearing one of those hats that looks like an English cabbie hat, so I may be confusing him for being English, but I don't know.
Ah, yes. It's the way that they dressed the mice back then, if you didn't hear their voices, is how you would tell where they were from. It was one of the great artistic choices that animators would make.
You think a lot of things are great.
Yeah, you're
only
a fan.
The most wonderful of things.
Hmm. I like that.
Do you ever not like anything, Bill?
Oh, geez, I'd have to think of an example. I don't like back pain, which I suffer from greatly every day.
Oh, that's right.
Day.
You're a very tall gentleman. How tall are you?
I am 6'11" in my bra and 7'2" on a good day.
Good news for boobs.
But yes, I hate back pain. I hate, everything that's bad has a silver lining, I like to say. So, right. Even the awful choice you made me make earlier of Mother Nature versus tie-dye, hated the question, but loved the opportunity to consider my beautiful love for Mother Earth and shirts dipped in some sort of chemical.
Right, right. Now, you are a famous relative, but you have a famous relative because isn't your son...
My son, Luke Walton of the Los Angeles Lakers, the University of Arizona Wildcats, bear down from the great Pac-10, now Pac-12 Conference of Champions. He now coaches one of the worst teams in the National Basketball Association, and many believe is wasting the talents of great players like Darren Fox and Buddy Hield.
Are you all right? Oh, my gosh.
Wow, yeah, you almost lost your breath.
One thing I hate is my son wasting the talents of the players on his team and is currently dealing embroiled in a sexual assault allegation that I hope is resolved positively for the accuser.
Okay, I don't know that we needed to bring that up necessarily, although I will say that last time we spoke to you, he was quarantining with you, but now he's out there in the world?
That's right, we heard my son's awful gravelly voice.
That's right, you have a very distinctive voice.
Natalie Palamedes episode.
Yes.
One of the great episodes of Pomedy Kang Bang.
Pomedy Kang Bang. Gang Bang?
Yeah. Now, Bill, you call basketball games. Is that right? That's what you do as a broadcaster?
Was that the first question you asked me when I came on the air?
Maybe. But that's why you're a broadcaster, right? You do play-by-play or something?
I do color commentary for basketball games, frequently with my good friend Dave Pash, who you can see me putting pies on the head of and generally annoying on the ESPN network. And you'll hopefully hear my voice every day for March Madness, the greatest month of the year. Beware the Ides of March.
The Immortal Bard, as previously referenced.
Yes. Oh, yes, Fortune, you must do one of the plays of the Immortal Bard for your next project.
One of the great bards. Am I right in that?
I don't even know him.
Scott, how could I forget William Shakespeare, one of the greatest bards of all?
Let's list the bards.
Well, there's the infinite amount of bards that people have created for their Dungeon and Dragon fantastical campaigns.
But Shakespeare rises above those, you have to admit.
Shakespeare is better than most of the bards that little nerds have invented throughout history.
Sir Francis Bacon, is he a bard?
A delicious bard, if you ask me.
Has one of the tastiest names.
Yes, Sir Francis Bacon, one of the most delicious sounding writers. You can eat Sir Francis Bacon's books with a nice egg in between a croissant.
That is a weird meal.
Yeah. So Bill, I mean, March Madness is finally here. Now, March Madness, explain it for people who don't exactly know what that is. I'm not talking about Fortune and myself, certainly. Mm-hmm.
Well, for those of you out there who are not familiar with the greatest 2 to 3 weeks out of the year, 64 to 66 of the collegiate basketball teams from the male and female side of the aisle clash, and it is in some of the most interesting games you could possibly have. Young boys and young girls at the peak of their talents competing for three-pointers, slam dunks, threw it down one time.
Wow, it truly is madness.
In my humble opinion, yes.
Sounds crazy. Between 62 and 64, you say?
Between 64 and 66, the NCAA added a play-in tournament for some of the 16 seeds.
I see. When what are brackets? Everyone's talking, Obama was always, he'd always fill out a bracket. What is a bracket?
Barack Obama, one of the great Between Two Ferns interviews!
Sure, of course, yes. But he had enough after the first one.
That's why he was a fantastic president. Leave the audience wanting more and then make a multi-million dollar deal with the network so they get all the Obama they can have, remember?
That's usually what you wanted with a president, to have them leave you wanting more. That's what we require of our public servants.
I think Nixon did it right. He left in the middle, and I spent the next 30 years thinking, what more could this man have done? We don't even know the possibilities.
Wait, are you a fan of term limits?
Absolutely, Scott. I'm glad you brought that up. I wasn't sure if you got my emails.
Please bring this up.
Oh my gosh, the constant emailing me about these.
Without term limits, our democracy is a mere oligarchy, leaving leaders to hold on to power forever. Even the Supreme Court should have term limits, and I will kill for that right.
Who would you kill?
Anyone opposing it,
or the Supreme Court? Wouldn't it have to be the whole Congress?
Anyone not respecting their term limit. And yes, I am 358th in the line of succession. So if I killed the whole Congress. Yes.
I had no idea the things you learn on this show.
Scott, check the lines of succession. Our broadcasters are on there.
Oh, holy God. Maybe I'm down there somewhere. I mean, I'm certainly under you, but I'm podcast famous at the very least.
Absolutely, Scott. I wonder which one of our names is more of a household name amongst the target demographic this time of year.
Well, I think in March, you reign supreme, certainly.
Yeah,
March is usually
madness.
An off month for me.
Well, reigning supreme is not... Yes, it is a mad time, Fortune, but I would never like to reign supreme because that's what people do if they do not have term limits, which is why I've come on the show today, Scott.
Okay, yes, please. Let's talk about it.
What time do you usually air your interviews on the ESPN? Because
They're usually around when the basketball games
I'm
are.
I'm afraid I haven't seen Bill's commentary,
well,
so...
Fortune, I feel that I don't know even how to welcome you into this world. I don't just do interviews during basketball games. I'm actually doing the commentary as the games are going on. So.
What if you were just doing interviews?
Sometimes we want to know more about the commentary.
Fortune is one of the great modern on-mic personalities. You should pitch this idea to the Entertainment Sports P
this
Network.
This is not a bad idea, because anytime I turn on a sports game in general, the people talking are always talking about the game. Look, I'm watching the game. I can see the game.
Yeah,
I don't need you guys
happening.
To talk about it. I would much rather listen to Fortune interview George Clooney while I'm watching the game. That way I get two things done at once.
Or reveal something about yourself. Like, that was a slam dunk. I like cheeseburgers.
Yeah.
Fortune, I gotta tell you, you would love watching me. This is basically what I do. If you want to watch a college basketball game, but have incredibly in-depth references to the history of Apple computers, then I am the announcer for you.
Oh, good, good. I can't wait to watch you in action.
Please, I will talk about Steve Jobs through the commercial break. We'll come back, and I'll still be in the middle of a story about one of the great turtleneck wearers of our times.
That's what you consider Steve Jobs to be.
Yes, the man wore a turtleneck like no college professor I've ever had.
He's another guy like Kristen Wiig, whose last name is something he had.
He had a job, yeah.
Yeah, he gave away a lot of them. Well, I mean, March is going to be over, though, soon. What does a Bill Walton do after March come April through February?
Send threatening letters to Clarence Thomas, Elena Kagan, Justice Roberts, and the rest.
Okay, sure.
Term limits now.
What are you going to do? Do you ever foresee a time when, you know, you're no longer going going to be interested in talking about basketball. You ever maybe thinking about sunsetting that particular aspect of your career? What does a Bill Walton do then?
Wow. What a question, Scott Aukerman.
From one of the great questioners.
One of the great questioners, from Oprah Winfrey interviewing Meghan Markle to
the,
Frost
the leaders
interviewing
of the Spanish
Nixon.
Inquisition.
Oh, and of course, the Spanish Inquisition, one of the greatest moments of time where questions were the number one part of it.
They were, I mean, on everyone's lips.
They were so inquisitive, these Spaniards. Now, I have never considered this much, you know, like the stories of Martin Scorsese's The Irishman or Quentin Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. My career is sunsetting, and what does a man do when he becomes irrelevant?
Dies.
I wasn't going to say irrelevant necessarily. Oh. I mean, I think you'll always be relevant in a way, but you know, maybe your interests lie elsewhere other than in watching that. It's an orange ball, is it not? It's round, certainly, but
yes.
it bounces up and down.
Or it's time to just give up.
Yes, do I watch the orangish ball bounce up and down, or do I say goodbye to this mortal coil and dive headfirst into my own grave?
I don't know that I asked you to do that. And why do you call it orangish? It's orange.
Well, when I think of orange, I think of one of the great fruits of our time, the tangerine.
Or a certain president that we've just had. Oh, my goodness. Don't get me started on that.
Himself.
Don't even say it. Don't, please.
Okay, well, you brought it up, but I won't get you started. No, I can't even
okay,
say
thank
it.
You. You think it's a brown orange? A burnt sienna?
What, the round ball that we rock with?
Sure, yes.
Well, yeah, like a burnt orange.
Yes, I believe it is more of a burnt orange if you were discussing it with the graphic designer and saying, let's make that. But it's more of a, if you play with the basketball in an elementary or middle school, it might be a brighter orange. Or if you're one of the Harlem Globetrotters, one of the great funny basketball teams, you'd play with the red, white, and blue ball.
That's
the
true.
Colors.
Of course. Yeah.
Patriotic.
But a lot of people, when they're children and they first start learning the game of basketball, you'll hear that a lot on playgrounds. Hey, pass me that orange ball.
It is the most common phrase on any playground with kids playing basketball.
Pass me that orange ball.
Otherwise, you may run into many mistakes if you say, pass me that orange. Someone throws you a piece of fruit. You say, pass me that ball. They throw you a football, which is Scott
sure,
mentioned
you
earlier.
Be very clear.
You got to be yes. very specific about which ball you want.
Absolutely. And if you're hanging around with some sort of joker kid who's really got no boundaries, he may pull out his testicles and you'll say, no, Tyler, no.
Tyler. Oh, my gosh.
That sounded like that happened to you.
Yeah, sounds like a very specific situation for yourself.
We've all got our Tyler. I'm trying to think of a fake name. Not the real one.
We've all got
Wait,
our
who's
Tyler.
The real one? Durden?
Yes, Tyler Durden, one of the
Do
great bullies
Tyler
of
Durden
my time.
I see him all the time.
Oh, you see Tyler. He's got some wild ideas and the man can't get over soap.
Well, Bill, you're you know, I envy you.
And this I love you too, Scott.
I don't know that I said I love you, but I envy you, certainly. March is your time to shine. This is, Bill Walton, every night of the week, he'll be out there. He'll be talking about that bright orange ball that bounces up and down through our television screens on the Entertainment Sports PN.
Wow, Scott Aukerman. To many, the segue into the commercial break or the next guest is considered a free throw. But you make it look like a layup, Scott Aukerman. The ease with which you transitioned from conversation into the end of conversation made me... Come, Scott.
Come.
Oh, whoa.
Oh, whoa.
Whoa. Wow. I don't think I've ever heard
I didn't
you say
see that.
That
coming.
Me neither, Fortune. And what a play on words. Throw it down, young Feimster.
Dunk.
Yes. Oh, wow.
Well, we do have to take a break, but when we come back, we have a, I believe, either a famous relative or someone with a famous relative. We got to get to the bottom of this. Can I enlist both of you to help me with this in case I forget?
Sure.
I swear on my life we'll get to the bottom of this.
Okay. I'm going to hold you to that. If we don't get to the bottom of it by the end of this show, I expect your life.
And it shall be yours. I'm a man of my word, like the Joker.
Wait, so you like the Joker? I thought this Tyler guy was too much like the Joker.
Well, you know, once the makeup makes the Joker a little easier to swallow, in my opinion. Tyler's right, just got that sexy, sexy face.
Okay. All right. Well, we do need to take a break. When we come back, we'll have the famous relative or person with a famous relative. We'll be right back with more Fortune Feimster, more Bill Walton. We'll be right back with more Comedy Bang Bang after this. Comedy Bang Bang, we are back. Fortune Feimster of Yes Plan. What
yes,
is
ma'am.
It?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, mm-hmm. ma'am. Of Yes, ma'am. Out on Netflix now. Netflix? No, what is it? Where is it?
Netflix.
Is it Netflix? It is Netflix. All right. You got a lot going on Netflix. That old building on Sunset in Van Ness. You know what I'm saying?
And an air ball coming back from break from Scott Aukerman.
What? I went from a layup to an air ball?
Just trying to make that street that Netflix is located on.
It's directly across the street from somewhere where you spend a ton of time, Scott Aukerman.
That's true, but I haven't been there in so long, I couldn't remember cross streets.
Oh, dear. You can remember the Denny's, though, can you not?
The Denny's. I'll
always remember the Denny's. We do have to, by the way... another air ball. Now you got me in my head.
Oh, one of the worst things that could happen to a basketball player. But meditation is one of my focuses, so meditate your way out of this one.
Okay, yeah, here we go. Okay, I'm back.
Wow.
Bill Walton also here. March Madness is happening. You can watch any of these games, and he'll throw down some interesting facts, and he will not interview people during games, though.
That's up to fortune.
That's okay.
Yeah, we'll find out.
Well, we do have to get to our next guest, and I have here he's a famous relative, but I'm not quite sure if that's the most accurate way to describe him, but please welcome Jacquis Robinson.
Hey, what's up, man? Hey, yeah, man, I'm not a famous relative, per se. I should be, but my ignorant brother took all my spotlight. You may know him, Jacquis Robinson.
Oh. Jacquis Robinson is your, did you say your brother?
My ignorant brother.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't want to repeat the ignorant part because I don't know that I agree with that. But
I got stories.
We're talking about the famous baseball player, right?
Yeah, we're talking about the famous baseball player, the guy who went to the major leagues and ruined my life for the worse.
Yeah, what he happened? Ruined your life, really. Yeah,
yeah.
What happened? By the way, for those who don't know what baseball is, it's that little white ball with the red
mm-hmm.
stitches.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They used to be orange in the day. People used to say, pass me that white and orange ball on the baseball field. That's what people used to say. But they don't say that no more. They don't say that no more.
So how did Jacquis Robinson, I mean, he's one of the most revered, just groundbreaking. I mean, Bill Walton can say this much better than I could, but he's looking a little tired.
He's shouting for the last 20 minutes.
He needs some water.
It occurred to me that I may have been peaking nonstop for my audio for the last session. Might be unlistenable.
No. But oh, no.
I'll leave that up to the engineers at Earwolf, some of the greatest engineers of our time.
Sure, the audio waves, what
but
they can
Jacquis
do with
Robinson,
those.
To me, is one of the great breakers of the color barrier from Jacquis Robinson.
All right, yeah, I mean, if you're going to throw that in my face, then I guess I can't say much, but let me tell you about the real Jacquis Robinson.
Okay.
Jacquis and Jacquis Robinson, closest thieves, you know, close like butter on toast. We were two beautiful brothers, loved each other. And then I had a beautiful career going in sports betting. Sports betting, I was making money because I couldn't throw no baseball. I couldn't hit no baseball. Jacquis Robinson could hit a baseball. Jacquis Robinson could throw a baseball.
You almost said basketball there.
Did he
play basketball? I know we were talking about basketball. Maybe
Jacquis
it's in
Robinson
your head,
played. Jacquis Robinson played basketball too. You know, but most people don't know that. Jacquis Robinson did a lot of things.
I didn't know that.
So he's like Michael Jordan, like a reverse Michael Jordan.
He was a reverse Michael Jordan. You know, I'm finding out. See, something you don't know about midway through his career, he retired from the game of baseball, and then he went to go play basketball in the ABA. He played for the Los Angeles Clippers. He made a movie called Universe Rock.
Space Jam.
No, that was Michael Jordan. Jordan. Jacquis Robinson.
Universe what? Universe Jelly?
Universe Rocks.
Universe Rocks. Okay.
Universe Rocks, which
great
jelly,
sound. Great soundtrack.
Jelly sounds is a lot better. Universe Jelly. Because
I mean,
Universe
they could have maybe punched it up, but it was Universe Rock.
But anyway, he went to the majors. And when he went to the majors, people started not to trust Jacquis Robinson anymore. They was like, nah, your brother in the major leagues, you probably get an inside tips. Mm-hmm. Or your brother in the major leagues, you can't bet on sports. So you know what happened? I betted on sports and I lost because Jackie wouldn't throw a game for me.
Okay, let me see if I'm getting this straight. You used to bet on games before Jackie played.
Yeah,
you were really good at it. You won a lot of money.
A lot of money. I won $14.
I guess back when Jacquis Robinson, before he was playing, what years are we talking about? That's
You're talking 1930s to 1940s.
40s.
Okay, so you're an older gentleman. But,
I'm actually my age. I'm still 29 years old.
Did you go through like some sort of wormhole or?
Well, listen, you know, I bet with the wrong people. I bet with Bugsy and them, and I owed them money, and I couldn't pay them, and they put some cement on my feet and threw me in the river.
Oh, little did they know. You were in suspended animation like Captain America?
Are you a ghost?
Captain who?
Captain America, he's been very popular over the past.
Yeah.
Since you've been gone, as Kelly Clarkson said.
Wow. Captain America. Oh, I didn't know America had captains. I thought they still had presidents. That sounds great.
No, he's not the leader. You don't get me started on the Cheeto and Cheese, please. All right.
How'd you get out of the water?
Well, apparently, the earth is warming, what they say. You know, they call it global warming and part of the ice.
About that.
Yes, I've heard about that after the fact because I asked that same question that Fortune asked. How did I get out? And they said the oceans are cooling or they're warming up and you melted, your ice melted. And that's how I got to here. Now I'm in Los Angeles, California, learning a whole bunch of stuff that I didn't know. Like apparently Jackie, as you said, was revered.
Revered. He went into the major leagues. You suddenly were no longer able to bet.
Mm-hmm.
But you asked Jackie to throw a game.
Yeah.
Which game are we talking?
Oh, we talking Game 7 of the World Series.
The biggest game of them all.
Wow. Did they play 7 games back then? In the World Series?
This is 1955, I'm assuming.
They played 7 games back then. They played 7 games, you know. Maybe they played 4 one year and then 3 the next year.
They would come back.
The third one.
The athletes were not really up to the modern standards back then. They got tired.
Yo, how much did Babe Ruth weigh?
Babe Ruth weighed 402 pounds. He was fat.
Wow. So you asked him to throw a game. He refused to, and that's what got you killed.
And that's what got me thrown into the river. And you know what I'm saying? If Jackie loved me like a brother's supposed to love, then he would have thrown that game for me. But he didn't, and now I'm here stuck in 2021 with learning a whole bunch of stuff I don't know.
Are you getting to bet now on games?
Well, I don't know sports now.
No, back in the day, you knew everything.
I knew everything. Now I don't know anything. I don't know. There's so many teams. There's other sports.
Yeah. Bill, you wanted to say something?
Oh, just that this is one of the great suspended and animation fish out of water backstories of our time. From Brendan Fraser's Blast from the Past to Michael J. Fox's Back to the Future trilogy.
Include Unfrozen Caveman Lawyer in there as well.
And of course, one of the greatest premises of all time, the man who went from caveman to lawyer, Phil Hartman, one of SNL's great character actors, hidden behind a mask in every episode, so much so that he told his own mother about it on a Mother's Day episode of Saturday Night Live.
I don't know anything you just said, my man, but you sound like one of them hipsters, and I like you.
You don't know what Saturday Night Live is. You couldn't even pick your best 7, and one has to do update.
I don't know what you just said, my man, but I like you. I like you.
So my God, no. I mean, everyone loves Jackie Robinson. I mean, he, 6-time All-Star, World Series champion in 1955, the National League MVP. Yeah.
Scott is saying this with his eyes closed, just spouting out these facts like Rain Man.
There was a movie based on his life a couple years ago.
Apparently, but that all could have been Jackie Robinson.
Do you know what a movie is?
Yes, I know what a movie is. Okay, you know, when I got thrown into the river, Wizard of Oz was the number one movie in America at the time.
This is in the 50s, though?
Yes, there was movies in the 50s, Scott.
I know, but Wizard of Oz is the number one movie in 1955.
Well, yeah, you know, we didn't have much. We released a movie, a movie every couple years back then.
And that they re-released Wizard of Oz. It was the Donner cut, I believe, that they did of that.
Yes, yes, they released
the Donner Party cut.
Yes, where Dorothy eats the Tin Man.
Oh, beautiful movie, beautiful and beautiful 120p. It was beautiful. It was nice and crystal clear.
Well, you've missed a lot. You've been asleep for 65 years. I mean, I'm assuming you just woke up, or because you're still wet. You're sopping wet.
I'm sopping wet.
I wanted to ask about that.
You know, I heard there was an open mic on this show, and I had to come tell my story. I didn't even attempt to dry off. The water cooled and warmed down, and I came right on.
You just
talk
came
to
right
you.
Here. Did you on the way over? Did you ask any kind of questions about the modern world or?
Yeah. I asked a couple questions. First question I asked was, where's the closest Wendy's?
How did you know about Wendy's?
Oh, you know, me and Dave, we was buddies. Me and Dave used to bet together, and he told me I got a daughter. And I'm gonna name my burger franchise after her, and her name was Wendy's.
And a square hamburger.
Oh, yeah. Did he tell you about that?
Now
did
he
you
told
leave
me,
that out?
He left that one out. I don't know what you're talking about, Fortune. Square hamburgers, but they sound
good.
He came up with a square hamburger. It was very, out of the box.
He cut off the little circular ends of each side of the hamburger.
Yeah.
One of the
and then
greatest
he eats those himself.
Square foods of our times. And yes, Dave Thomas eats the little ends, and that's how it started. He would eat the crusts off of the PB&Js, but those didn't do as well on the menu, so he kept to the square burgers.
Yeah, I remember him eating the crust off the PB&Js. It was beautiful. It was a beautiful sight. He was a good man. So I asked where the first and the closest Wendy's was, and they
where
told
was
me
it?
It was right on some street called La Cienega.
Well, Los Angeles, they built it up over the years. It's very different. Did you float to Los Angeles?
Yes, they
else?
Threw me into the Atlantic, and I floated over. I crossed.
Did you
the
go
Panama
through the
Canal.
Panama Canal?
Yep, I went through the Panama Canal, and I came into the Pacific Ocean, and here I am.
It's very cold, right?
That helped. That saved my life. How cold it was. Yes.
The Panama Canal. Theodore Roosevelt speaks softly and carry a big stick. Fortune, I think this is more important. Son of other presidents, father of other presidents, and brother to all of mankind. The teddy bear named after Theodore Roosevelt, one of the
Thank
greats.
Thank you, Bill Walton.
All right.
I was saying, do you have any family?
I got a daughter. She's much older than I am now.
Yeah. You've been gone for 65 years. How old is she now?
She's 70.
Okay, so you had a 5-year-old daughter.
I had a five-year-old daughter. She got grandkids that are older than me right now.
Oh my God, what a weird situation. And you came right from the beach and you know all this already.
Well, you know, that was the second question I asked. I asked somebody, what happened to the Robinson family? And they told me, they updated me, they told
After
me about
you had the Wendy's burger, you suddenly, like, you were feeling a little better and your head cleared, right?
Yes, I had
you
a little
been very
bit more.
Hungry.
I was so hungry. I had
it for a long time.
The last thing I ate was fish.
A celebrity dinner that you didn't even know was a celebrity dinner. The button to every great story.
Or a tuna melt.
You know, there was some good tuna, there was some good fish, and I was the celebrity in my mind because I was wealthy and I was losing my money, and which is why I needed Jacquis to bet, you know.
And you weren't eating the fish under the water.
I was trying to stay alive and eating the fish under the water.
I thought that you were in suspended animation. You were, but every once in a while you'd wake up and eat a fish and then go back to sleep.
That's
like
right,
it was Thanksgiving
Scott.
Dinner.
That's right, Scott. Every
the belt on your pants.
Every Thanksgiving, apparently I would wake up and a fish would be right by me. I would just chomp it up and suspend back in animation.
Wow. Now that's something to be thankful for.
Well, it sounds like global warming worked out well for you.
For the rest of us, it's not been great, but...
Is that right?
Yeah. Well, I think all of our, your daughter and your grandkids and everything, I mean, we're all projected to die within the end of the century.
There's a lot of avalanches happening right now.
Yeah, wildfires, everything. But for you, it was great.
It was great for me. And let me tell you, it's going to be a sad, sad day to see my daughter and my grandbabies die. But, you know, one thing that I will say is people look a little bit better nowadays than they did back then. So I'm attracted to everybody on in Los Angeles right now. Yeah. I hope to start a family.
It's kind of an LA thing. I mean, LA sevens are, you know, like other states. Tens, you know.
Oh, is that
mean?
Right?
Or, yeah.
Is that right? Now I was a Brooklyn 15. I was a Brooklyn 15 back in the day. So
you're
an
LA 4. I'm just looking at you right now.
LA is tough. It's a tough city.
LA is tough, but
I'm not allowed to leave my house.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Also, nothing's changed apparently from the 50s. We're not allowed to leave our houses.
That's just this year that you have been. We're actually at the tail end of it. Hopefully, we're in the middle of a global pandemic. Yeah. Were you around for the first one in 19?
Oh, the Spanish flu. Yeah. I was just born. I was born in 1917. I got contracted with the Spanish flu when I was 2.
Oh.
Which It gave me a beautiful mind. That's how I knew sports so well. I just knew it was going
to
happen.
It's like you're attracted to pandemics.
Well, I never thought of it that way.
Yeah, you keep.
Are you blaming me
when
for
there's a pandemic?
Yeah, wow. You're like the harbinger of doom.
You're like Bill Skarsgård's character from season 1 of Castle Rock, one of the great.
Man, I don't know Steven, what
you're
saying.
Not going to know any of this.
He's
going to mention streaming services. He's going to mention Hulu. He's going to mention Stephen King. There's
a
lot of stuff.
Stephen King universe all in one place. We're talking Misery. But not just Misery, Cujo is there, and all of it on Hulu, where you can find the new television show, Kenan, starring the great Fortune Feimster as a sports...
Sports.
Is it caster? Are you a caster if you're recapping the sports?
I'm a caster of sports.
Oh, so you're on TV. All right,
yeah,
Fortune, man, you got to have a conversation after this is over.
Yeah, okay.
Of course, you know what TV is. It had just been invented.
Yeah, I can't wait to see some beautiful black and white TV.
There's something even better. Colors.
What? Yeah.
Colors. They putting colors on TV now?
Well, okay. They are indeed. But they have color, you know. You've heard of Roy G. Biv, I'm sure. Okay, God, they didn't invent that back then? Red, orange, yellow.
Oh, the RGBs.
Green. Yeah,
yes.
No, RGB, unfortunately, is no longer with us.
Yeah.
And I know she was around.
My apologies to all the fans of RGB, but something had to be done about the term limits. A message had to be sent.
Oh, no, Bill, that was you?
RGB?
I was going to say, I don't know who RGB is, but I did have a friend who had three similar initials. RBG. I wonder whatever happened
to her. What about the Bee Gees? Do you know who the Bee Gees are?
The Bee Gees? Oh, man, they were 5 and 6 years old when I went into the water. They were some beautiful kids.
They became famous.
Children.
I knew them as children.
They had beautiful singing voices, and they had like so many number one hits. They wrote for other artists.
Wow.
Dolly Parton. Speaking of good news for boobs,
the white lady.
Right.
you knew Dolly Parton.
Oh, I knew Dolly. Don't get me
started.
She's
helping us get out of this pandemic. She helped with the vaccine.
Create the vaccine, and she also wrote Jolene and I Will. Always love you in the same day.
Mm. Wow.
Well, it seems like the world has gotten like a much better place without me. And the thing that I'm upset about is, imagine what the world could have been like with me. And if Jacquis was the one in the water, I could have bought so much money and capital to this.
He's the guy who refused to throw the game. They should have thrown him in the water.
They should have did that. That's what they should have did. Scott, if I ever get back to my time, I'm bringing you with me to have you talk to, you know, Muggsy and all that.
You want to go back to your time?
I do want to go back to my time. Yeah.
Things are so much better nowadays. I mean, look, Jackie Robinson made a big, big difference with cultural perception. And I think people, remember when you came from? I mean, a lot of people were not having it so great now. And things are minimal.
What are you talking
better.
About?
That's a great catchphrase from a TV show that was on.
That was a very popular TV show.
Whoa,
really?
Great catchphrases from what you're talking about, Williston, and I do that from eat my shorts to don't have a cow, man.
I don't know what you're saying, brother, but it sounds good, man. It sounds good.
I actually think you'll like the world a little better, and a lot of that, or at least a small sliver, is due to the change that Jacquis Robinson, your brother, brought about.
Yeah, he made a big difference.
Well, you know, listen, the only difference I know he made was he took the Dodgers away from Brooklyn and took them to Los Angeles. So, you know, but apparently I'm also a bad coin because I bring pandemic. So maybe the Robinson name just should die with me. You know, maybe it should just die with me.
Yeah, all Robinsons.
All Robinsons. All Robinsons.
Even Tim Robinson from I Think You Should Leave?
Tim Robinson.
He's very funny.
Tim Robinson. All the Robinson name should end with me. It should have ended with me. It's going to end with me.
Swiss Family Robinson?
No!
No, they can stay. The Swiss, is that hot chocolate?
No, that's Swiss Miss, one of the funniest haired women on this God's green earth.
Even your nephew, David, who is a coffee grower and social activist in Tanzania.
Oh. My nephew's still alive?
Yeah, he's still out there.
Oh, man, I got to go say hey to David. Where are you at? Tanzania.
Tanzania? Is that how you say it?
Tanzania. Come to Tasmania. Come to Tasmania. Come to Tasmania. We mean you.
I don't think you know what that is either. I don't know that I do either.
The Tasmanian Devil, one of the loodiest of tunes you can come across. From now, Bugs Bunny to Lola Bunny, all with normal-sized breasts in 2021.
Wait a minute.
Bad news for boobs for fans of Space Jam, unfortunately.
Bad news
from what
for boobs.
That sounds bad. Also, I'm good. I'm glad to hear that the Looney Tunes are still making good comedy.
They're still so funny.
Yeah.
You're going to love them.
I can't wait. And apparently, they got boobs now, so I can't wait to see that. I can't wait to see
if
that.
If you're horny and want to laugh,
but no,
the Looney Tunes are for you.
It has been 65 years, so I guess I'm going to go watch, what you call it, Space Jam?
Yes, check out Space Jam.
Well, I mean, sports betting, it's gotten a little more complicated. There's all these kind of parlays and you can bet on coin flips now. I don't know if you use... Yeah, in the Super Bowl, was that around back then?
The Super Bowl, was that a toilet?
No, it's the biggest football game of the year, and they have people like Shakira and J-Lo playing during the halftime and The Weeknd. Do you like The Weeknd?
Wait a minute. Saturday and Sunday have become sentient beings and they playing music?
All right, that was, Bill, you got to admit, that was a layup.
Right? Now that was an alley-oop from Scott Ackerman to Jacquis Robinson. Wow! Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, step right up to one of the great setup punchline duos of all time.
Oh, my God. I don't know. To be honest, I kind of wish Jacquis Robinson had been thrown in the ice and then woken up like Captain America these days, because
that
the world doesn't need
cool.
another sports better, but we could use another Jackie Robinson.
Are you saying the world don't need me, Scott?
I mean, you know, what is it you do? You go hang out in casinos in Vegas. Vegas became a big popular gambling destination since you've been gone.
Yes, I go to Wendy's. I hang out in casinos. I make bets. I'm the toast of the town here. And when I was in Brooklyn, I don't know what I could be in Los Angeles. I think you should give me a chance.
Yeah, I don't even know. How much money did you say? I mean, it's wet money, but when it dries off, how much did you have in your pockets?
Oh, I have $14. I still got them in my pocket.
Okay,
all right.
You're not rich anymore. That's less than what the minimum wage should be.
You spent three at Wendy's.
Three? I could have got something for $3. My meal was $9.95.
They were dollar menu.
Dollar menu. The Wendy's dollar menu, one of the great fast food affordable eats options from a small Frosty and fries to a Dave's famous star.
A junior cheeseburger.
To a junior cheeseburger.
Man.
Yeah. Unfortunately, inflation.
I just walked in and said, give me your tastiest burger, and they passed me this and said that'd be $9.95. That's what happened to me.
$9.95? Wow. Are you out of your mind?
It was delicious, though. It was delicious. So all I got left is $5.
There's a lot that's happened. I mean, hip-hop music is now the most popular music and culture in the world. I mean, we're talking Ice-T, Ice Cube.
Why is there so many ISIS?
Oh, don't get me started on ISIS!
Oh, no.
One of the greatest
terrorist organizations.
No, we have time to talk
ahead,
about ISIS.
You know the drill.
Yeah, you know.
So wait a minute. There's ISIS the terrorist, ISIS the cube, and ISIS the T's?
Yeah, but we don't have time to explain ISIS to you. QAnon, that's another thing. Don't even look that up when you get home.
That's what if Jackie Robinson's unfrozen brother became became a Q follower.
Oh, no. Listen, I do like the letter Q. That sounds like something. That sounds like people that I can get in with.
No, please don't.
No, okay.
Don't make that the first thing you look up. You'll just go down a rabbit hole.
Yeah. Okay. Look up where is my daughter first.
Yeah, but you only have $5 to your name. What are you going to do? I mean, that's not going to get you even a hotel room. Like even a seedy flop house wouldn't put you up for $5 a night.
Well, I was hoping that one of y'all would make a bet with me, you know, one of the greatest bettors of all time. I was hoping one of y'all would make a bet with me, get me back on the right foot. So that's what I was hoping for.
What do you want to bet on?
Well, you know, I was listening to, you know, there was something that Bill said, something called March Madness.
March Madness.
Mm-hmm. I can get you plus 300 on all the Arkansas Razorbacks winning the SEC tournament.
Well, now I don't know what that means, but what I know.
Well, the types of bets that you used to make were like, will the Dodgers win? Yes or no?
That's all the bets I used to make.
Right.
But I had one bet. I got another bet, you know, because I don't know who's in the games and now what. But Scott, I will bet you.
Okay.
My $5, and if you lose, you have to pay me 500% of that.
Okay, so I'll pay you the equivalent of $5 1950s dollars now.
Yes,
so
whatever absolutely.
That's Mad Men money.
Okay.
Bill, you will know the answer to this. How many teams are in March Madness?
And you want me to say?
Yes, Scott, I want you to answer that.
Scott agreed to the bet?
Well, I've agreed to it. Yeah, agreed to it. Yeah.
And Scott, I said it earlier in this episode when I was defining March Madness to Fortune.
Yeah. I got to say it's between 64 to 66.
Wow, Scott, with the memory recall, you never know if you're doing a podcast and the host is listening or just on autopilot, but Scott remembered every word I said.
I remember.
You're taking my last $5.
Give me that $5.
No, somebody throw me back in the ocean.
All right, who's going to throw him back in the ocean?
I've got a bad back, but I'll walk you to the ocean and let you walk on out in a sort of
teach a man
suicide.
To swim out to the ocean
get
frozen for a lifetime.
Hop in my car.
Screw Jackie for making me lose 65 years of my life.
This is terrible. The wrong brother is alive. That's all I have to say. This is a terrible situation.
Oh man, take his money and
take my money and take my pride.
All right. Well, look, guys, we are running out of time. We just have time for one final feature on the show, and that is, of course, a little something called plugs.
I'm not a hologram, but I played one on TV from 1989 to 93. I'm here to help my friend, whose name is Dr. Sam. Every week I try and hope I can.
Nice. That was The Ballad of Dean Stockwell by Barnacle Joe.
I don't know what that racket was I just heard, but it sounded bad.
That's what music sounds like now.
Is that what music sounds like now?
Well, there's also, I mentioned hip-hop earlier. There's hip-hop and R&B, I don't know.
Okay.
And Stockwell, EDM. You can always count on Dean Stockwell to deliver from Quantum Leap to Battlestar Galactica. Dean Stockwell fans love the man.
Yep, that is true. Get acquainted with Dean Stockwell, Jackie's.
Yes.
The way this man fights with a little handheld computer that he's also kind of has a weird relationship with as a hologram is amazing in Quantum Leap.
Of course. All right, guys, what are we plugging? Fortune, you have a lot of stuff out. Let's get to it. What do you got to plug here?
There's Yesterday on Netflix, the Netflix Afterparty, whenever the next episode eventually comes out. I have a podcast called Sincerely Fortune, And I'll be going back on the road, hopefully in the fall. So I'll be announcing tour dates. In like a couple weeks.
Let that be your first field trip outside of your house is to go see Fortune Feimster in a theater near you. Mm-hmm. Incredible. Let's see. Bill Walton, what do you want to plug?
Well, I suppose I would rather rocket to the moon of the options I've been given here.
What?
Is this not the would you rather section?
Oh, no. You always make this mistake. No, this is you heard a theme song, so you got a little thrown off.
Yes.
No, this is where we're plugging our projects here.
Oh, well, obviously, I actually am not sure if I do the March Madness commentary, but keep an eye out on ESPN for
sure,
me. Make sure you make your voice heard about ending term limits across the United States. And check out biggrandewebsite.com for a comedy podcast project from the comedy group Big Grande, an Easter project coming out around the corner.
Oh, and incredible. Of course,
patreon.com/you'retheman now dog for an improv and conversation podcast.
All right. And Jacquis Robinson, what? Yeah. I mean, look, you just got out of the water.
I just got out of the water. But you know, the fifth question I ask the person is, I'm on my way to a podcast. What do I do? And they say, you got to have something to plug. And I found out what a plug is. And the sixth question I ask is, does anybody else have my name? And I found out there's this young brother. His name is Jacquis Neal, who has my name. So I looked into what he's doing and I got some things to say about him. He's a smart man. Beautiful man. He had a show here on Earwolf called Culture Kings. It got nominated for a podcast that your show is nominated for, Scott Aukerman.
I saw
your face on there, so that's a good thing.
The mark of quality.
Yes, the mark of quality is your face, and he's on the same poster as your face, and he has another show.
Of podcasting.
The who?
Sure.
Paul Newman.
Yeah, you don't know Paul. You probably know Paul Newman.
I know Paul Newman. Paul Newman was old when I was young.
But you don't know Newman from Seinfeld.
No, I don't know who Seinfeld is. That sounds weird. That sounds weird. But also check out Jacquis' new show. It's something called The Cast with Ray and Jacquis. It's supposed to be really funny. I'm going to check it out when I learn what a podcast actually is.
It's like radio, but on your iPod. Never mind. Why am I even bothering?
You can be at
home. I don't have a home.
Yeah, you don't have $5.
Yeah, you got to find a home first.
Podcasts are free. Don't ever fall for this whole Patreon thing where people are asking you to pay for them.
Well, hang on now. That's
well,
not
somebody told me. Somebody told me something about Stitcher Premium.
No. Podcasts are free.
Oh, okay. All right. Well,
they're
then,
the best value for your money. Cheaper than Wendy's. Dollar menu.
Thank. Oh, well, I don't know. I didn't do too well at Wendy's, so we'll see how I do. See how I do with podcasts.
Yeah. I want to plug, speaking of podcasts, the nominated for that very same award, the podcast Threedom, which is just myself, Paul F. Tompkins, and Lauren Lapkus sitting around shooting the shit and playing games and talking with each other. We tape it out here in my backyard. And that's every Thursday. So fans of this show should like that show. So listen to it every Thursday. It comes out for free. All right, we're going to close it up, but we have a brand new remix. Let's hear this one. This is Brass Mouth Plug Bag Remix by Brendan Hogan. Let's close up the old plug bag.
You gotta
open up the plug bag.
Open it up.
Open up the plug bag.
Make sure it's not closed.
Open up the plug bag.
Make sure you got oxygen.
I see you dancing at the discotheque.
Why can't we be friends?
I see you dancing at the discotheque.
Wow, that really took some liberties with it, but I really enjoyed it. Thanks so much to Brendan Hogan. If you have a remix, send it on by. I don't know that we've repeated a remix this entire year. This has been great. Thanks so much for all the remixes. And speaking of thanks, guys, I want to thank you so much for being here. Fortune, great to have you on the show for the first time. A wonderful addition to the canon.
Thank you, Scott. It was a blast, and I appreciate you having me on here.
But of course. And Bill Walton, always great to see you. Congratulations to March Madness. I know that come April 1, you're going to just just slip into that hot tub and get a little bit of bubbly and say, God, I did it, didn't I?
Well, March Madness does last usually a week or two into April, but I do get on the hot tub on April Fools mostly because every year I trick myself into thinking my bathtub is a hot tub. And I'm the fool.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful tradition. And Jacquis Robinson, so great to see you. I'm sorry I took your money, but you know, and I would give it back, but a bet is a bet. And
a bet is a bet. That's one of the things I believe in. I wouldn't ask for my money back.
Did you make any bets before you got frozen that might have, you know, paid off and you have money just waiting for you?
Oh.
Well, I don't know. You know, I bet at some point, this was a stupid bet, but somebody was like, pick a fruit. And I was like, apple. I was like, apple. And they was and I was like, I bet you $20 million. I just said that.
Wow.
$20 million right. That one day, this name is going to be one of the most famous names of all time, and I don't know how it shook out, but I'm sure.
Wait, who is this guy that you bet? Did he have a name that was sort of like what he was giving out to people?
Something with Steve Work.
Was he wearing a black turtleneck?
Steve Jobs. Yeah, he was wearing a black turtleneck. Black turtleneck.
Robinson!
Good news.
You have $20 million in an escrow account somewhere.
What? Is that for real?
That's for real, but for it's real?
I don't know what the escrow is, but as soon as I find out, I'm going to go ahead and eat it.
But let me tell you, it's not $20 million in 50s dollars. It's $20 million now, which is sort of like, I don't know, that might get you a house here in L.A.?
Damn!
With no privacy.
Things have changed. Might get you a nice tutor out in Silver Lake. Nothing on the west side, certainly.
Oh, damn! With $14, I used to have a beautiful Upper East Side apartment in Manhattan.
Sorry, no.
Yeah. Times have changed.
But hey, it's something. It's a start. $20 million is a start. So good for you.
All right. Well, I can't wait to spend it.
Okay, well, congratulations to you, and congratulations to you all. We will see you next time. Thanks. Bye.